Hey Steve, how are you this? I was gonna say this morning, but it's actually afternoon.
Well, I'm doing okay. Thank you so much, Alex. It's wonderful just to be able to talk to you and your friends and those that gather around you on a regular
Yeah.
basis.
While you're saying that, I noticed your plaid shirt seems to be perfectly ironed, and I'm wondering if do you iron your shirts or.
I still do. As you might recall, when you were my associate pastor, we had a handful of conversations about
We did.
session and your freedom from ironing.
Yeah, still completely free, but I'm thinking when I occasionally drive through Colorado Springs, I could drop off
How would you?
my dress shirts.
I mean, for I think the common, I think a 25 cents an item, would be,
I think I'm guessing you get joy. Like you're probably closest to the Lord when you're ironing.
It's
And I'm
what.
having a flashback to our India trip together when my luggage didn't come in and I
I
had to
know.
borrow some of your underwear. And I don't remember it being ironed at all.
I remember a flashback to of some meeting you and I had, and I mentioned you needed to dress up a little bit for it, and we both had like khakis and collared nice shirts on, and I remember asking you, do you keep your shirts stored in a Pringles can?
I did that on purpose to make you look good because my job as your
Was
assistant
right, and
pastor was to make you look good. And I really did. So today we're talking about generosity, and of course this is connected to missions and really the wider topic of people participating in multiple ways to help make ministry happen. And specifically, I asked you to do this because you've been in ministry forever, since you were like 12 or something like that.
well, you know what? Not 12, but 2 weeks ago was the 45th anniversary of when I was ordained. My ordination certificate's on the wall here, and it's February 15th, 1979. Here it is.
Calvary Chapel of Downey, which is in a suburb of LA.
Right,
Yeah.
it's right in L.A. and mega church. In fact, the senior pastor who ordained me, or hit the whole, of course, the board ordained me, but the senior pastor there.
People like you and I are in a peculiar situation because we're dependent on the generosity of people with their time and their energy and also their money.
We're not
And
producing any consumable or marketable product.
hopefully, yeah, if you think of the church or missions as a marketable product, then maybe there's
We're not,
something wrong.
nothing that we are doing is making money for anybody.
We're a nonprofit and we're dependent upon that. Is that humbling and frustrating for you?
Back in middle 1999, I was really beginning to sense that God was doing some major reset in my life. I was still the senior pastor of the Vineyard Church in Colorado Springs, and at that point, for the last 5 years prior to that, to be most energized and alive when I was in an international context, teaching or equipping or training leaders. That just seemed to be my thing. And then he said, "I think you should be doing that full time. I think you should. We should look at a transition out of your senior pastorate, and you need to be doing this." And I said, "But Randy," I said, "I can't raise money. I can't be on support. I don't know how. I mean," and I'll never forget. Randy looked at me and said, "How long you been in pastor and church ministry?" And at that time, 2 years, I don't know. And he said, "Every Sunday of your life, you've been up on a platform where you guys are convincing people to give approximately 10% of their income every week in a basket that goes down the row." Now, I understand we have different ways of giving now, but digital basket, whatever. And
Right.
he said, "You already know how to raise money." He said, "You've been," because I felt embarrassed at the idea of asking people to help support what I sensed God was calling me to do. And his point was, this is
You're
an
already
experience.
doing that. I wonder if we feel like a church service is more of a marketable commodity than disappearing and being in the mission field. Like somehow it's more quantifiable because people are
Are
coming
providing
in.
a service. We're providing an hour and a half of spiritual content and or entertainment and or and we also provide additional services, depending, I guess, on what level of membership you have. We'll do a little bit of counseling, we'll do weddings, funerals, hospital calls. And there is a sense, we'll take care of your kids, we'll have a youth group, we'll do all these things. I still don't like doing it. I've just become better at doing it. And at the same time, I've seen the incredible fruit from allowing people to participate and be partners with
them. So let's talk about, is this just sort of a religious sham, or is this biblical? Is there a basis for people participating and helping people like us actually make a living, survive? Or is this just sort of some racket that religious people have come up with?
Well, there are rackets out there, and the naysayers will immediately go to those rackets. You know, like if you go to the scriptures, I mean, generosity is listed in Romans 12 as one of the spiritual gifts. You know, the one who's given the gift of generosity had been be generous. And I think I was just looking at in 2 Corinthians 6 through 8, particularly 8, where Paul is commending their generosity, and his language, it's like God is blessed you, he's given you all this so that you can be the conduit of blessing to others. And I was thinking even about our church. I'm no longer a senior pastor, but we are active in a local church here in Colorado Springs, and have been since its inception about 12 years ago. Every week, the end of our service is the Eucharist around the, you know, the Lord's table. And our slogan, if you will, is blessed, broken, and given. And it rides on, first of all, of course, Jesus' words at the Last Supper. You know, he blessed the bread and the cup. He broke the bread and he gave it to the disciples. But you go even beyond that. In the feeding of the 5,000, he took the fish and the five loaves and he blessed it. He broke it and he gave it and it multiplied out to the people. Mm-hmm. And so the prayer in our liturgy every Sunday, which is largely from the Book of Common Prayer, is at the end is that through Jesus himself on the cross being broken for us and you know, him blessing the bread and the wine, breaking the bread, giving it to us, that we who've been blessed by God, broken in the sense that in our own sinfulness, we repent and we come under the redemption of Christ and the blood of Christ, we are now given for the sake of the world.
That